Good morning. Can you hear me in Southampton? Do you see both presentation and that visualizer with pencil? Okay. Yeah, just in case battery will be flat in the microphone, please shout loudly what sound is lost. Okay. Yeah. All right, so briefly recall what we did on the previous lecture. So we return to the point of view what cycles represent points in certain space with indefinite metric, and we briefly revise what shall be in place of Cauchy-Schwarz inequality for inner product space for the spaces with indefinite products. And we discovered what all three possibilities exist. So not only the standard Cauchy-Schwarz inequality, but opposite inequality may happen for some vectors. But that is preserved by the pencils spanned by corresponding vector, the type of inequality. And moreover, the inequality or equality identity for this type of vectors means certain conditions related to tangency relation. And so we was able to produce a certain geometrical description for tangency of cycles in terms of corresponding inner products, and that is a quadratic relation, one of the example of higher order invariants of Möbius transformation. Of course, tangency relation preserved by Möbius transformation. If we have two tangent cycles and then make Möbius transformation, image will be a tangent cycle again, tangent cycles again. And here is a sample of what we have as certain quadratic pencil of cycle in the cycles in the cycle space. So I recall what linear pencil is given by such pictures. If we visualize points in the cycle space which belong to the straight line, when it's produced with linear pencils, which are very popular in the standard geometry. And if we will build a certain quadratic shape, so it's like a sphere or hyperbola in the that three-dimensional projective space of cycles, then the visualization, the implementation in the point space will look like shown on this slide, with tangency to two given cycles A prime and B prime. So this is how that quadratic pencil look like. So when we moved to certain metric condition for the cycles, we said what we can measure the size of a cycle by its determinant in normalized form. So it has the standard meaning for circles and rather explicit geometrical meaning for parabolas. And then we define a distance between two points by means of a certain variational principle. We look for minimal value of cycle of minimal value which pass both points, and diameter of such cycle will be the distance. That will be a rather degenerate relation again for the parabolic situation. It's shown here on the right hand side half of that plane. So degenerate value depend only on horizontal coordinate, not vertical coordinate. And that is again, maybe geometrically it looks degenerate, but it's correctly represent a point of view for Galilean space-time or space-time of Newtonian mechanics, where we have absolute space, absolute time, they are separated, so we cannot mix like one with another as in relativity. But we also was able to discuss more a big really set of what we call lengths. That is related to the measurement of distances by, again, rather classical tools when we put one leg of the compass in one point and looking for what shall be the size of cycle which pass the second point. So we just looking for corresponding size of cycle passing another point, and that size of cycle will be given as the length. And there are a large collection of such lengths. they all has infinitesimally covariant, so the ratio how lengths are transformed by Möbius transformation is constant regardless of the direction. So it's in this term, length became quite legitimate objects, always 54 lengths became legitimate objects to investigate within Erlangen approach, where we are looking for invariance or covariance of certain transitive group action. when we have length, we may come back to the idea of straight line in certain new aspects. We are looking for modification of classical geometrical ideas. So in classical geometry, in Riemannian approach, there is idea of geodesics. So that is for given distance function on the manifold, that certain curve which minimize the distance between two points. So if we have points Z1 and Z2, so traveling through geodesics takes the shortest distance. but here, when we are looking for non-Riemannian case, that is again, in Riemannian case, the metric is positively defined quadratic form, and we have not necessarily positively defined, it can be indefinite, and even indefinite, it's oftenly Riemannian metric, oftenly called pseudo-Riemannian, and it's not too singular. So if transition from Riemann geometry to pseudo-Riemann metric is more or less straightforward, the biggest problem appears when we are moving to the degenerate case, the signature of corresponding quadratic form may contain zeros. So that is what we are called parabolic case, and in this case situation became different. So and that happened with the standard Riemannian situation is that if we deviate from the geodesic in any way, that will lead to the increment of the traveled distance. So in the usual Riemannian set. If we are looking for an extension to kind of metric which is not necessarily positively defined or even degenerate, situation may be different. it may be what there is no shortest distance at all. Just come back to some of previous, sorry, jumped too far. So here is an example. What if we are looking for the shortest possible path between Z3 and Z4 in parabolic situation? There is no shortest one because that degenerate situation of two vertical lines would which broken and say joined into infinity, that will be shorter than any other parabolas passing with two points. So what happened in parabolic case so may not necessarily look like a Riemannian situation. But that question was already investigated by some mathematicians, and Blumenthal suggests what geodesics in the case where minimal or maximal value for the distance along the curve not necessarily occur, we may still be interested in the property what a distance is additive along the curve. Actually, it's a weaker condition than the standard geodesics, as easy to see, because for geodesic, if you have these two points and a geodesic between them, and you split it by any intermediate point Z, then that distance Z1 Z plus distance of Z Z2 shall be equal to the distance Z1 and Z2. So that is possible to deduce from geodesic property from shortest distance. If that will not happen, so curve is not geodesic in Riemannian case. But so that allow us to replace the variational definition of geodesic to some wet additive property. In this respect, we look for the distances or expressions which would be strictly invariant under the Möbius transformation. I recall on previous slide we studied infinitesimal similarity, proportionality of distances, so conformality property, so that is was satisfied by many distances and all lengths. So there are, say, 56 different functions, and probably this is not all functions which satisfy similar that conformality condition. But if we ask not infinitesimal conformality but exact isometry of Möbius action, actually answer is rather rigid what can be supplied as the distance. If we ask for isometry action, then expression is like that. We are using the double U's represent complex, dual, and double numbers with usual agreement what the conjugate of double U, which is maybe U plus epsilon V, conjugate is usually U minus epsilon V in this usual case. And essentially, numerator in this case became U squared minus sigma, where sigma is again square of the corresponding imaginary unit V squared, divided by U. We are speaking about the distance between two points, so two coordinates shall present. So explicitly, the both expression, distance between double U1 and double U2, will be U1 minus U2 square root minus sigma V1 V2 square root divided by imaginary parts, this is V1 times V2. So that isometry property, actually, it's very easy to see what in case of in elliptic case we get exactly Lobachevsky distance, Lobachevsky metric on the upper half plane. And that expression not so degenerate in parabolic case, although in parabolic case sigma is equal to zero, so that term disappear, second coordinate still appear in denominator as a product. And clearly, if this expression is isometry, any function f, whatever we choose, of this isometric expression will be still isometry. So we have freedom to choose this function f from that expression. Then what came out, what we may ask for the that Blumenthal definition of the straight line, what curve will be satisfy the additive properties of distance along this curve if we use that isometry action. And answer came out rather straightforward. So what if we want straight line will be from our family of cycles, so elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic respectively, when we need to take function f capital, which is an arbitrary choice in general, to be inverse sine, arc sine, of this expression, where sine taken is a usual sign for the hyperbolic case and a hyperbolic sign for elliptic case and just function 2x in the parabolic case. If we are choosing these functions, then corresponding straight lines in the sense of Blumenthal will be corresponding cycles, corresponding type of cycles. So, and here is the pictures, visualization. So the first one, top left corner, you may already seen on several occasions if you studied Lobachevsky geometry, non-Euclidean geometry somewhere, or actually this is the picture which we already had when we discussed action of the subgroup K on the upper half plane. So subgroup K in the elliptic case fix the corresponding imaginary unit, complex imaginary unit. So this is a fixed point. So orbits with green circles here will be, in this case, equidistant point from the imaginary unit. So because they are orbit under this action, under this rotation, so distance shall be preserved. So that is contour line, equidistant point to it. And when straight lines, blue one on this picture, is has additive property and they are orthogonal to the equidistant curves at every point of intersection. So this is the straight lines in Lobachevsky geometry, which are half circles perpendicular to the real axis, with diameter on the real axis. This is straight line in Lobachevsky geometry, and this is why that model appeared in the non-Euclidean geometry, because you have here corresponding violation of the Euclid fifth postulate. So if you have upper half plane, you have certain straight line, which is half circle, you have another point where are infinitely many other parallel non-intersecting straight lines, which is again half circles passing that other point, and that is in contrast, is in difference to what we have in Euclidean geometry. So this geometry became non-Euclidean. For other pictures, probably from the top left corner, we will move to the right left. So this is hyperbolic rotation. Here is replace the Euclidean rotation. So here is subgroup K, which produce with rotation in the upper half plane, in the elliptic half plane, in hyperbolic half plane, corresponding rotations, which fix imaginary unit, is produced by this matrix cosine, sine, sine, cosine. It's fixed not only the imaginary unit J of double numbers, it's as always in this Minkowski space-time geometry, fix the corresponding null cone, two crossed lines passing this point. If point is fixed, corresponding light cone, null cone passing this point will be fixed as well. And then corresponding rotations and distances here appears as again on this picture. So we have this hyperbolic rotations, again green lines here were not so visible, here on the other picture were more thick. This is green lines are equidistance point, because they appeared as orbit of rotation, isometric action. So that is equidistant point, curves from the imaginary unit. And blue curves run as straight lines. Distance is additive. Distance which is considered here is additive with respect to this corresponding function. So that is, again, in some sense, we are able to see a similarity between two opposite corners of this picture, but that similarity became even more explicit if we fill the gap between them by parabolic situation. So parabolic situation, again, it's if treated straightforwardly, looks most degenerate, but due to this degeneracy, there are certain freedom to get more flavors of replacement. So here we are considering corresponding rotation, or again, which fixed imaginary unit epsilon for double numbers. So this is given by this group of lower triangular matrices, and that thick yellow curves on this picture is isometric, equidistant for that isometric action. And since imaginary unit is fixed in Galilean space-time geometry, any vertical line for this point will be fixed as well, so vertical axis is fixed. And then we have a choice, so you may see here we have three type of different distances here. In each case, green parabolas are the same, which is which are yellow on this picture. So that is equidistant point. But what are the corresponding distances? What is the corresponding straight lines with additive distances? It's a matter of our choice. We may take it in the elliptic case, when this picture is as close as possible to the Lobachevsky geometry, if we replace circles by parabolas, so you may compare these two pictures, or we may take parabolic and hyperbolic situation, and then the last picture may be as close as possible to hyperbolic case. So if you will compare these two last picture, so they're as similar as these two upper pictures are similar, again, if you replace circles or hyperbolas by respective parabolas. Again, the important property of the Lobachevsky space-time that we have two types of directions in the Lobachevsky, in Minkowski space-time. So let's recall what we have here, say, coordinate and here time. And our distance function is Lorentzian metric, x squared minus t squared. when unlike Euclidean metric, it can take any sign. It can be bigger, equal, or less than zero. And that property or shall be, of course, invariant under Möbius transformation. So if it's equal to zero, we have the light cone. So this is equality to zero. That region in on this side will be, say, space-like. And that correspond to the intervals, space-like intervals, for events which can be placed into simultaneous time by certain Lorentz transformation. So it's space-like intervals. So its t coordinate can be placed equal to zero. So for any point in the that region, we have certain Lorentz transformation which put t equal to zero. So that means it will be simultaneous event with the origin. And here, this is other complement will be time-like intervals. For these intervals, we have definite time ordering. So we, for this interval, we have positive and negative light cones, half light cones, where we may say what events from this part of the space-time happened before when time at the origin, and say this one happened after the time which is at origin. So, and for events which are space-like, that can be simultaneous with the origin. So this is the property of Minkowski space-time. So there are invariant subsets, and here we correspondingly have space-like straight lines. So distance positive and additive along them. So here that region. And here we have time-like straight lines. Distance is negative, but still additive along with blue lines. So here are two hyperbolic regions. And as you see, if you have that metric, Minkowski metric, then for a certain region, you may travel from imaginary unit by straight line to corresponding point. So that is given to with solid blue lines. So this is points in this region which can be connected, but you cannot travel by this type of straight lines outside of this region. So in parabolic case, we have a similar situation. As you can see, there is certain horizon, so which you cannot surpass if you are traveling along straight line. So here you are approaching horizon, and after that your straight line became imaginary, so it's tangent to that isometric one. So you have kind of similar shapes. So here in the parabolic version, that horizon is a real line. You can travel by the straight line to any point in the upper half plane, but cannot go to the lower half plane. So that is a gap between elliptic and hyperbolic geometry filled by the parabolic geometry. So as you can see, all that three cases rather uniformly connected. So we may really benefit considering them in one setting. Okay, next, so we will return to that space-time and structures and positive and negative value of this form later, when we will speak a bit about cosmology and redshift. But now let us discuss another connection between distances and certain angles. So, so far, we introduce, if you remember, the first part of our invariant study was about angles. We have orthogonality relation. And for the next part, we introduce distances and length. And so far, it was looked disconnected. So it's two different areas of invariants with no relation. Now we introduce relation between them. So let us again start from the rather standard elementary consideration. If we have a straight line and we have a point, if we considering Euclidean distance on the plane, then the shortest distance to the straight line, of course, is given by the perpendicular. So this is very well known property. So if we draw perpendicular, it will be the shortest line, shortest distance, shortest interval to the straight line. Formally, what does it mean? So if I have here AB and direction of my line, I would say, is given by vector, say, CD, when the shortest distance mean what the distance of the vector AB plus CD as vector has stationary point at t equal to zero. So small displacement to the left or to the right will increase our distance. If we will go slightly to the left or slightly to the right, the distance will be bigger. Of course, that property of perpendicular is connected with the cycles, because in Euclidean geometry, because if we will put our cycle in the picture, then cycle or circle here represent points which are on the fixed distance. And if our line is perpendicular to the radius of the circle, then it's sitting completely outside of the circle. And when we have perpendicularity of the radius and the corresponding tangent line at this point. So if we take any other line, when part of this line will be inside of the circle, so it will be closer to the center of the circle, and other part will be outside. So that point here will not deliver, so that will be not delivered by the green line, so stationary property. So this is how well-known facts from Euclidean geometry work on the Euclidean plane. So what we can tell for our distances and lengths, which was defined before, for the corresponding cases. So again, we may have take any distance or length and say what interval AB is perpendicular to interval CD, to the vector CD, if we still have that stationary point condition in corresponding distance or length here. And this is not symmetrical relation. So if I have, say, AB perpendicular, so I use that not symmetric sign for perpendicular, that does not imply perpendicularity in the opposite direction, unless we have something like Euclidean geometry, something special. So in most cases, that relation is not symmetric. And actually, that relation is connected to some previously considered notion of so-called second or focal orthogonality. So actually, again, just comparing that idea with the distance through the circle from the center. So length from the center using the circle. So if we will look on corresponding construction for the focal orthogonality, what happen when lines pass in this focal orthogonality, straight lines are passing the corresponding focus of the parabola of a cycle, and it is orthogonal to the corresponding direction of tangent thing. So here we have the corresponding orthogonality condition expressed through the focal orthogonality. So in general, perpendicularity and orthogonality as defined in our course. So again, on Euclidean place, this is words with the equal meaning, but in that richest set of geometries, part of orthogonality and perpendicularity coincide, but there are some significant differences. So what are conditions? If we use the distance as was defined through the diameters, so distances which was defined through the diameters, when these distances and sigma to be plus or minus one, so elliptic and hyperbolic case, the perpendicularity is just the same as orthogonality defined before. And I recall what in hyperbolic case, orthogonality of two vectors means what light cone bisect angle between them. So light cone bisect angle between them in hyperbolic case. And in for lengths, from foci, perpendicularity as defined from through this length, just the same as focal orthogonality. And here again, worth to be considerate what focal orthogonality means in usual Euclidean set meaning. So in focal orthogonality, we have a parabola, we have its focus, so perpendicular vector will be tangent to the parabola, and it's known what that angles are equal. Other way around. Not with angles are equal. So direction which is done by vertical line and line to the focus give equal to the tangent one. So that angles are equal, and this means what the stream of vertical rays coming to the parabolic reflector will be just collected to the focus, which is very well known property of parabola, which by legend was used by Archimedes, who used that reflection property to make fire from Roman fleet, which invades his island. And nowadays we use these properties in satellite dishes when the signal from satellite coming actually almost in parallel rays is collected in one point where is that beam receiver is sitting and taking the maximal signal from that parallel stream. So just that well-known classical property of parabola can be equivalently stated what these angles are equal, and that again give rather close similarity between the hyperbolic and parabolic case. So here we have that connection between different relations. Next topic, which we probably just start today and will continue on the next lecture, is the connection between different models for our SL2R geometry. I recall what we have started our geometry from the homogeneous spaces. So general construction was as follows. We take our group G and certain subgroup H, then consider the homogeneous space, and then a left shift on the group produce corresponding action on the homogeneous spaces. And we take a collection of all one parameters, different one parameters continuous subgroup up to similarity. This is A and K. And we consider corresponding homogeneous spaces, and that leads to linear fractional transformation on corresponding hypercomplex numbers. But here there is a certain choice which we have silently made. We parameterize points of the homogeneous space by a pair of reals. In this way, we embed a pair of reals into SL2R by the following map S, and that determine our property, our expressions for linear fractional transformation. That parameterization of homogeneous space is not unique, so there are many different parameterization, and they lead to different expression correspondingly as action of the pair of real numbers. What will be the image under such a transformation? It's significantly depend on our choice of S. Although they are equivalent up to certain transformations, so we can define a map from one parameterization to another, which just corresponds to these pictures. So what is advantage of that previous choice of S, which we have considered? It was universality in the sense what for all cases in the free geometries, elliptic, parabolic, and hyperbolic, the same map S work well and produce a uniform representation for the action. So whatever was our subgroup H, either A and K, we still have the same set, which is upper half plane, invariant under action in all three cases. And that allow us to study with three geometries simultaneously. But if we will be more concentrated on one particular geometry, upper half plane may be not the best picture in some respects. And we, for example, may want to have a compact model, something which, again, here, upper half plane, it's infinite. So all our drawing just shall stop somewhere, not covering entire plane, but we may have an equivalent representation in the unit disk, and that is just given by another parametrization, by another composition of map S from this type of embedding of homogeneous space into SL2R. But probably better we will speak about details of these compact representations of the homogeneous space on the next lecture. Are there questions?